Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program today, we have Jim Forbes and we have Shane McLoud, both of whom are with Wolfpack. And we'll get into what Wolfpack is in a bit. But I'd like to ask you guys how you got to Wolfpack. Shane, you started out in education. Tell us your journey.
My late 20s, I started off as a teacher teaching elementary school in South Central Los Angeles.
South Central?
Yeah.
Okay.
For LA Unified. Taught in Watts for 7 years, third and fifth grade.
Okay.
Then I switched to a charter school in just west of downtown. Was on the school board for Santa Monica Malibu Unified School District. Was on the personnel commission. Even was involved in my teacher's union to try to internally reform and improve teaching profession within the districts.
How did that work out for you?
It was very difficult, but all that experience and a master's degree in public administration I had more of an interest in policy. I even worked for two county supervisors prior to teaching in LA County on transportation issues. So I think I've always had an interest in fixing the system. I don't teach full time anymore, but I teach as a substitute here in Sacramento, and moved up here 2 years ago to work for a nonprofit education reform organization.
Can you tell us which one?
Yeah, Students First.
Okay.
I no longer work for them, but I'm volunteering with Wolfpack, with a couple other organizations, trying to create a collaboration of organizations that will support election reform, reducing the influence of money in politics. And I think unless those things are done first, none of the issues that are important to us, whether it's education, immigration, in marriage equality, anything is ever going to be reformed. So that's what I'm dedicated to now, and I really appreciate you having Jim and I on the show.
Jim, you are, I guess we can, is it fair to say, a recovering attorney?
I'm a recovering attorney.
Okay, yeah. Tell us about your history of litigation.
Well, I've been a lawyer for about 35 years. I graduated from McGeorge School of Law here in Sacramento in 78. And I moved up to Oregon. I was a lawyer there for about 5 years. Moved on up to Alaska, 15 years in Alaska, back to Oregon. And in the early part of the last decade, in the 2000s, you know, we started seeing the housing bubble growing and growing and growing. And that impacted a lot of litigation work. When the crash happened in 2008, a whole lot of legal work dried up, and I started doing personal bankruptcy. And day after day, I would sit there and I'd talk to new clients and try and figure out how these are good people. These are honest, hardworking people that just had the rug pulled out from under them. And I just started thinking, well, why did that happen? Well, the housing bust happened because there was a housing bubble. And the housing bubble happened because Wall Street had been spending billions of dollars on lobbying and influencing Congress and getting themselves deregulated to the max. To the point where they were selling mortgage-backed securities. Nobody knew what they were. Nobody knew how valuable they were. And when people were not able to make their mortgage payments, the pin went into the bubble. The bubble went pop, and a whole lot of good people went down the financial tubes with it. And I started looking into the situation. I started seeing that this was a Wall Street buy-off of Washington, D.C. policy. And then 2 years later, Citizens United was decided in 2010. And at that point, I just decided, you know, I want to do something about that.
And that's where Wolfpack comes in.
Well, that's where, yeah, indirectly.
Okay, tell us what Wolfpack is, who's involved in it, and what the goals are.
Well, Wolfpack was formed by a gentleman named Cenk Uygur. And Cenk Uygur is a talk show host of a show called The Young Turks. And about a year and a half.
Is that on cable?
Yeah,
yes.
On cable. About 2 years ago, I think it was.
And internet.
And internet, yep. About 2 years ago, he, like a lot of people who were concerned about money in politics, the Citizens United decision, you know, we'd been seeing that it had been years since the Citizens United case. There had been a huge public outcry. Public sentiment is heavily, heavily against that decision. But nothing was happening in Congress. Nothing was happening in Congress. And so Cenk Uygur, on the belief that the only way to deal with Citizens United and the money in politics was to amend the Constitution. Congress is one way to amend the Constitution, but they weren't doing anything. The other way to amend the Constitution is through the states. And if two-thirds of the state legislatures call for a it's an Article 5 convention. It's not a constitutional convention. That's the wrong term. If two-thirds of the states call for a convention under Article 5, then Congress has to hold the convention. The convention delegates can draft an amendment. The amendment has to go out, and if it's ratified by three-quarters of the states, it becomes part of the Constitution. So Mr. Ugar had the idea that this was the only way to change things. When I moved back to Sacramento about a year and a half ago, I was looking for an organization to volunteer for, and I found Wolfpack, and it's been a good fit.
So you're defining the problem as money in politics. Is that a fair summary?
That is the most important problem.
Okay,
yeah.
Obviously it costs money to run a political campaign, and obviously politicians have a great deal of influence on what happens. You mentioned bankruptcy and the housing bubble and banking law and that sort of thing. Obviously, politicians can write laws that favor one interest over another, and it's usually moneyed interest over people who don't have as much money. It's, you know, pure public interest theory means that politicians will do whatever suits their own individual needs as politicians first, and that usually means getting as much money as they can from folks who want to affect the legislative process. So there's an inherent desire and an inherent bias in the current system for money to go to politicians to skew the way legislation is written. So obviously we have, you know, and by any other, in essence, I think what we're talking about is bribery, but legalized bribery.
Yeah, correct. Money in a paper bag,
no,
like the old style.
It's still the function.
It's on the table.
The function is the same.
Yes.
Okay, so you guys want to get rid of money in politics.
Well,
what does that look like? How do political campaigns get paid for if there is no money to buy the airtime, no money to buy the flyers, no money to pay the walk around guys in the precincts?
There are all kinds of different ways, but let me just put it in the context of what the Supreme Court has been doing, because the reason that the big money is in politics is because of U.S. Supreme Court decisions. The first one was in 1976. It was Buckley versus Valeo, and in that case, the Supreme Court said there can be no constitutional limit on how much a candidate can spend for office.
On his own campaign.
Right. So after Watergate in the early 70s, Congress passed a whole slew of reforms, which were mostly struck down in Buckley versus Valeo. Well, think about it this way. How did the United States finance political elections between, let's just say, the end of World War II and the Buckley decision? I'm not meaning to answer your question with another question, but my point is that the history of the United States is replete with periods of time, epochs where big money in politics was not a problem.
I think you can go back to the administration of George Washington, who spent money to get his political supporters drunk so that they would be more interested in supporting him. I mean, political corruption, if you want to look at it that way, it's been going on since before the Revolution.
But it's exploded since 2010.
Okay, and I would ask the question, why do you think that might be? Would you think that might perhaps be because government is taking it upon itself to do an awful lot more meddling in the economy now than it did 200 years ago?
No. And I'm not saying the government isn't doing more to meddle.
Mm-hmm.
That's not my point.
Okay.
So you agree
they're doing more to meddle?
That's a point of view issue.
Okay.
One person's meddling is another person's wise regulation.
Okay. And I think it swings back and forth depending on who controls Congress and who's in the White House.
Okay.
But let's define corruption a little more. Put a final point on it. Okay, there is individual corruption.
Mm-hmm.
That's the bag of money.
Sure.
Okay. Then there is systemic corruption, and that's what we're dealing with. Systemic corruption occurs when a system is no longer working the way it was designed to work. Okay. So you've seen on your computer, you'd be typing along, you'll get a big error message, and it might say file corrupted. Well, what that means is the file's corrupted in the sense that it is not in the form that the code writer intended it to be. That is the problem with the United States today. The founders of this country intended for Congress to be dependent on the people, the voters alone, and not to depend on the people who paid for the elections. They should depend on the people who vote in the elections, not the ones who pay. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about a system-wide corruption where Congress, not every member, but the majority, where the majority of Congress depends on these funders that pay for the campaigns, pay for these ever-increasing election costs. And believe me, after Citizens United, the cost of elections is going like that.
Okay. Going along with your premise that it's the money buying politicians or buying the system is the problem, mm-hmm. what would the Article 5 convention hope to achieve?
Wolfpack leaves that to the convention. Go ahead.
Yeah, I don't think there's
well,
any.
Well, obviously,
that
you're supporting a convention. You want that convention to do something. What do you want the convention to do? What is the solution that you're, you know, the ultimate solution you think that convention should
do? It's like trusting the jury pool to make the right decision. We do believe if a convention is called, the right people, the states will send the delegates. They'll have a healthy discussion. They'll focus, I think, primarily on the influence of money in politics and what constitutes or which the argument of whether an individual has constitutional rights or artificial entities like they do now. I think that'll be the main focus, and I have a lot of faith that the right outcome will occur.
But how are the delegates selected for a convention like that, for Article 5 convention?
That's up in the air because there's never been one.
I understand that.
Our best guess.
Well,
yeah. What do you speculate?
We anticipate Congress members themselves not appointing themselves. We anticipate them approving it, which they have to approve once 2/3 of the states call for it, or in other words, 34 states call for it. And we are going to, or at least I'm going to push a good mix of delegates from the states, non-politicians. I think I support the jury concept. I think average citizens who have the interest, who express the interest, can go to the convention and represent the public better than elected officials.
I have a theory about elected officials, which is this. The people who are elected to public office or who want to be elected to public office are people who have a bigger desire for power and control than they do for just about anything else. Therefore, the kind of people who aspire to get into politics tend to be toward the sociopathic end of the scale.
Do you see Mr. Smith goes to Washington type politicians out there initially?
I don't see very
and
many.
And then they become corrupted?
I don't see very many like Mr. Smith.
Yeah.
And the few that remain uncorrupted, I could count probably on one hand. And I don't think that's going to change no matter how much or how little money is in politicians.
Okay, well,
the goal of the politicians is to have power.
Okay, I don't mean to interrupt you, but
go ahead.
Okay, let's go back again. This is where I think that it's useful to focus. The United States of America between 1945 and 1976 did not have an excess of money in the political system. Now, presumably, the politicians were the same sociopaths that you're talking about today. It's the money that makes them make bad decisions. It's the money that takes their eye off the ball. It's the money that keeps them from thinking about the voters first they decide how to vote.
Bring up health care reform and the influence there.
Okay, let's talk about health care reform. I mean, health care reform, you know, we're talking about a system, pre-Obamacare, mm-hmm. that's a very corrupt system in the sense that government says to hospitals, you can't build a new hospital unless we give you permission to build a new hospital. Who gets permission? The people who grease the most congressional or local politician pockets. You have a system where you have to go through an untold number of hours of years of college in order to get a medical degree. Probably, and physician assistants and RNs and other paramedicals are prevented from doing things that they could very easily do. And so you're artificially restricting the number of people who become doctors and who become other medical professionals. You're restricting the labor supply to keep the price, the salaries up.
You're bringing up bad governance.
Exactly. And I'm saying that the reason that those things happen is because public choice theory. The people who have an interest in keeping the number of doctors low, and that have an interest in keeping the number of nurses low, have an interest in keeping the number of hospitals low, are the people who are going to benefit from that. Those are the people that in any system who are going to either spend the most money, if money is the way is the currency in politics, or they're going to spend the most time, if time, you know, spent twisting arms is the currency in politics. They're the people who care because they're most directly affected. They're the ones that are going to have an undue influence on the political process. Whether it's money or elbow grease or walking precincts, it doesn't really make a whole lot of difference. The root issue, the root problem, is the fact that politicians are writing laws that restrict competition.
Yep.
And that's the problem. Well, so I would suggest that if you're going to have a Article 5 convention or a constitutional convention,
Article
the best way to do it.
Not a constitutional convention. Because, you know, the reason I say that is because they are not empowered to rewrite the Constitution. They're only empowered to propose
an amendment.
Individual
okay.
amendments.
Okay. I would suggest that that amendment be a separation of government and the economy. We have a separation of church
Perfect.
And state. Why not have a separation of,
you know what?
Of state and the economy?
That's exactly
that way you don't have the ability for politicians to rob from Peter to pay Paul.
You should be at that convention.
You should be
but
at
I
the
won't
convention.
Be. I won't be because how do you think the delegates are going to be selected?
Okay.
It'll be
well,
a political process. That's the problem.
First let me say that that it sounds like we are on exactly the same page to the extent that the way I put it when I'm talking about it usually is an amendment that provides for the separation of money from politics. You're talking about the economy from politics. Maybe there's a distinction there. Maybe
big distinction,
not.
Because if you don't have something to regulate, then there's no need for money in politics.
Yeah. Well, okay, but several points here. One is, how are the delegates selected?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, under Article 5, if two-thirds of the states call for the convention, then Congress is cast into a ministerial role. Congress is not a decision maker at that point. Congress decides where the convention is going to be initially. The convention delegates can move it later on. Congress is just required to call the convention.
I'm just looking up the language.
No, go ahead.
Article 5.
Article 5. Keep going, Jim.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. The states... This is a convention of the states, okay? So it's going to be the states that are going to decide who the delegates are. Almost all, like I say, there's never been an Article 5 convention, so some of this isn't completely hashed out. But the scholars that have written on this subject agree that it is the states' convention. And so the states are going to pick the delegates. Individual states might have different methods of doing it. Maybe the legislature in one state will pick them. Maybe they'll have an election in another state. But it's not going to be Congress that appoints the delegates.
It'll
Article,
be up to the
Article
states.
5, let's see here. What does it say? The Congress, whenever two-thirds of both houses, that's not what you're talking
no,
about.
No, I'm talking about the Senate.
You're talking about the second clause. Let's see here.
On application of two-thirds of the states, find the application word.
Let's see here. I'll just read the whole thing. Okay, there you go. Application of the legislatures of two-thirds of the several states shall call a convention for proposing amendments, which in either case shall be valid to all intents and purposes as part of this Constitution when ratified by the legislatures of three-fourths of the several states or by the conventions in three-fourths thereof as the one or the other mode of ratification may be proposed by the Congress, provided that no amendment which may be made prior to the year 1808 shall in any manner affect the first and fourth clauses. It doesn't say anything about how the delegates are selected, as far as
no,
I can tell.
That's right. That's right.
So, it's
but
chartered
it is,
territory in a way.
It is the states.
So it's going to be a political process.
Right. And so then it's up to individuals
to push
the state legislators and governor to insist that it is the best representatives possible.
I see money talking when it comes to picking those delegates. I don't see how you get money out of it.
Look,
I would suggest that the other fear I have about a convention would be that you might be
run away.
Exactly. Yeah, you might be proposing it for this purpose, but it can go anywhere.
No,
it won't.
Why? Why not?
Well, are you going to get three-quarters of the states to ratify?
Oh, I'm not saying that it would be ratified. I'm just saying that.
Some crazy person says, let's overturn Roe v. Wade. Let's outlaw certain kinds of, you know, laws, marriages, fine. Let's have a vote on it. even if it gets 50% on the floor, 38 states will never agree to it. Fine, mm-hmm. you had your vote. Now let's get back to serious issues.
Okay.
Let's turn it around.
And also, Congress today could pass anything. So the fear, the red herring of a runaway convention in order to not support an Article 5 convention doesn't work. Congress can pass any crazy amendment today and throw it back to 38 states to pass. And why don't they? Because they know it'll never get passed by 38 states.
Yeah, and listen, your bigger problem is you got a runaway Congress right now. They're either in a do-nothing mode or they're in a runaway mode where they're doing all kinds of things that libertarians don't like meddling with the economy.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you've got a problem right now. So your choice is to just continue living with that problem or do something about it.
Okay.
Let's do something about it.
There's one part of the Constitution which still is pretty much respected and which I totally agree with, and that's mm-hmm. the First Amendment.
Okay.
And the First Amendment talks about the right of free speech.
That's right.
The right of freedom of the press. Right. It also talks about the right of assembly, the freedom of assembly.
That's right.
And a corporation is nothing more or less than an assembly. An economic assembly of a group of people.
We're not out to undo corporations.
And if an individual has the right to free speech and free press,
mm-hmm. yeah.
which requires property, requires wherewithal to print mm-hmm. the newspaper or to buy access to the microphone, right. if an individual has that right, why do not a group of individuals have that right? You're arguing that a corporation, since it's a group, loses its First Amendment rights.
No, and I'm glad you brought that up because it's an important point, but it's wrong.
Why is it wrong?
Here's why it's wrong. We're not out to abolish corporations.
You're talking about them not speaking.
No, I'm talking about them not using their vast corporate treasury funds.
You can't talk without
speaking. Wait.
You cannot speak effectively unless you have a dais.
No, look. Money is going to be entitled to some protection. It always has been. That's the way it is in this country. We're not talking about taking away the First Amendment. Corporations are going to continue to be corporations. They're going to continue to be groups of people. And they're going to continue to have the rights to do the things that corporations do. But look, a corporation is just it's a state charter. That's all it is. It's a group of people that organize under a state charter for the purpose of doing business and making money. And the problem with allowing a corporation the power to give unlimited amounts of money into political campaigns is because you've got this accumulation of wealth that was put together because the state granted this particular charter. Okay,
if
the state granted the charter,
let me finish. Okay.
If the state granted the charter, why can't the state put a limit on the charter? That's all we're talking about. We're talking about limiting under the First Amendment.
Why should the state be limiting a group of free individuals on how they decide to do business together?
Because
in the first place,
you're taking an absolutist view of the First
Absolutely.
Amendment. Okay, let me put it this way. This is how maybe it was Justice Holmes or somebody. Your right to swing your fist ends where my nose begins. Okay?
Spending money.
Do you disagree with that?
Spending money is not getting anywhere close to anybody's nose.
Absolutely, it is.
No.
You couldn't be more wrong. Let me give you an example. All right. Okay. Do you enjoy being ripped off economically?
Absolutely not.
Okay. Do you think it's someone else's right to rip you off?
I think it's my job to prevent myself from being ripped off. I think it's the legitimate role of the government to enforce, to promulgate and enforce laws against fraud, laws against theft, laws against assault, and so forth.
Okay.
So to the extent that government exists, what it should be doing is preventing the kind of activity that you're talking about, physical theft, physical fraud, assault, fraud.
Good. Okay.
But that's it.
Can I tell a story about how money...
Is this going to be a courtroom story?
No. This is a Congress story, okay? All right. Medicare Part D. You heard of it? Drug benefit.
Okay.
All right. Okay. So in 2003, there was no prescription drug benefit.
Mm-hmm.
So seniors wanted it. The drug companies wanted it because they could sell more pharmaceuticals. And Congress thought it was a pretty good idea. So they started working on it.
Sure, because they were getting greased by the pharmaceutical companies
and
by
the
seniors.
Now, let me finish the story because I'm going to totally underscore what you just said because I totally agree with what you just said. During the time that Medicare Part D was under consideration, pharma is the lobbying arm of the pharmaceutical industry. They had 824 lobbyists on Capitol Hill. That's 1.5 lobbyists for every member of the House and Senate. They spent $239 million on lobbying. Now, that is a lot of junkets. That's a lot of trips to the Super Bowl. It's a lot of trips in private jets over to St. Andrews in Scotland for golf outings. Okay? They spent $87 million on campaign contributions just during that cycle that Part D was adopted. That's a total of $326 million. Now, what did they get in return? Here's the ripoff part.
Well, they got 1,000% return on their investment, I'm sure.
It's even worse than that. Yeah. Here's what they got. They got a law that says that Medicare cannot use its market-given bargaining power to negotiate lower prices with the drug companies.
You don't have to convince me that big business is buying whatever they damn well
choose. That's where the fist hits the nose.
I'm trying to convince you that you're getting ripped off. And Let me just finish the story. Okay.
We have 2 minutes.
They spent $326 million, one-time expense. They got a law that says Medicare cannot negotiate prices. Now, we know that results in a massive overcharge because the Veterans Administration can negotiate prices because they were formed in the 30s when nobody thought about putting that in. Every time the VA buys a pill that costs a dollar, they pay 54 cents. Medicare pays a whole dollar. $11.2 billion every single year the taxpayers are overpaying the pharmaceutical industry because of the $326 million the big pharma paid out to get that law passed.
And the root problem here.
So you're getting ripped off because of the money in politics.
Not for
any other reason.
The reason I'm being ripped off is because politicians have the power to regulate the economy.
Look,
get rid of that power. Make your Article 5 convention say that you cannot regulate the economy. Then there would be no reason, no ability for the politicians to enact a monstrosity like Medicare D, and all of the rest.
You missed an important point of my story. You did. I said that the Veterans Administration was formed in 1933. Nobody in Congress dreamed of giving a giveaway to the pharmaceutical industry like that.
Because they've been practicing since then.
The VA can negotiate prices. It's all because of the money that went into Part D. So you're getting ripped off. I'm getting ripped off. It's because of the money that the politicians are legally allowed to accept because of the Supreme Court decisions, which ought to be overturned.
The problem, of course, is that you're never going to be able to get rid of financial influence. Money is fungible, whether it's money on top of the table or money under the table or a gold nugget appearing in a safety deposit box in Switzerland. You're not going to be able to get rid of it.
In the 1960s, this country got things done. Okay, that was before big money.
Politicians have had a lot of time to practice.
No, it's not about practice. It's about the Supreme Court. That's why we need the convention.
Thank you very much for being a part of the show. We really appreciate it. We're on the internet at www.accesssacramento.org and on Channel 17 in Sacramento. Thank you very much. See you again next week.